Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Age of Caesar, Five Roman Lives, by Plutarch, translated by Pamela Mensch and James Rom, read by Michael Page. Preface. James Rom. By 31 BCE, after serving as a battleground for Rome's civil wars for more than a decade, the cities of mainland Greece were exhausted and starving. In rapid succession, the great generals and political leaders of the age, Pompey, Julius Caesar, Brutus, and Octavian, had despoiled the region's food stocks to feed Roman troops. Finally, in flight from Greece after his defeat at the Battle of Actium, Mark Antony tried to extract one more shipment of grain from the citizens of Chaeronea, the smallish city-state in Boeotia near the oracular site of Delphi. Greeks who lived there were whipped by Antony's soldiers as they carried loads of grain across nearly 20 miles of rough terrain to the Gulf of Corinth, where the retreating ships of Antony and his lover, Queen Cleopatra of Egypt, were waiting. Among those pressed into this ignominious service was one Nicarchus, the great-grandfather of Plutarch. They had made one trip of this kind, and when the second load had been measured out and they were about to put it on their shoulders, news came that Antony had been defeated, and this saved the city. For Antony's stewards and soldiers immediately fled, and the citizens divided the grain among themselves. Plutarch records in Antony, perhaps recalling what he himself had heard as a child at his great-grandfather's knee. The episode has little historical importance, but it is the one direct link Plutarch makes between his own experience and the events of the Age of Caesar, roughly speaking, the middle third of the first century BCE, the era that saw the rise to power of Julius Caesar, his murder on the Ides of March in 44 BCE, and the subsequent wars among those seeking to claim or eradicate his legacy. The world was a quieter place by the time Plutarch was old enough to understand his great-grandfather's tales. Born around 45 CE, almost a century after Caesar's assassination, Plutarch grew up in the Greek province of a Roman state that had resolved its internal quarrels and subdued nearly all its foes. His life in Chaeronea was untroubled by the depredations of Roman armies. The era of Nicarchus' youth, in which much of the world had been caught up in the rivalries of towering generals, must have seemed far off. Yet it was that era, and the similarly turbulent era 3 centuries earlier, that had seen the rise and fall of Alexander the Great, to which Plutarch gave the most attention in his Parallel Lives, the collection of historical biographies for which he is best known today. The Age of Caesar furnished him with 5 of his longest and most compelling lives, superb illustrations of the thesis that governs the collection as a whole, that character, the endlessly varied contours of the human soul, shapes not only destiny for the individual, as a famous Greek maxim maintained, but the history of nations as well. As a well-off, intelligent youth studying philosophy at Athens under a teacher named Ammonius, Plutarch had glimpses of the great imperial power that resided in far-off Rome. In the late 60s CE, when Plutarch was in his 20s, Emperor Nero, pursuing the delusion of a singing career, came sweeping through Greece on a concert tour, and the Greeks prostrated themselves before him, even posting an honorary inscription on the pediment of the Parthenon. In 68 and 69, after Nero died without an heir, the Greek world watched nervously as 4 rivals battled for succession, resulting in a victory for Vespasian, the founder of the Flavian dynasty. This brief taste of civil war, after a full century of Julio-Claudian rule, served to remind the world governed by Rome of how much was at stake in the stability of its government. It was a lesson Plutarch kept firmly in mind when he later wrote about the far worse civil wars of the Age of Caesar. Unlike others who wrote about those wars, the Roman poet Lucan, already dead by this time, had been a contemporary, Plutarch never questioned the legitimacy of the political system that they had produced, the autocracy today known as the Principate, because its rulers were euphemistically dubbed princeps, first citizen, rather than emperor. Probably during his years in Athens, Plutarch became acquainted with Quintus Socius Senecio, a high Roman official then governing Greece, who later twice rose to the pinnacle of Roman politics, the consulship. The two men developed a warm bond based on pursuit of shared philosophic goals, and Plutarch ultimately addressed to Senecio his parallel lives, as well as two of his non-biographical essays. Another powerful Roman, a senator named Lucius Mestrius Florus, later helped Plutarch obtain Roman citizenship, and Plutarch thereafter adopted the man's first and middle name as part of his own. Florus, too, would later become consul, a second among the nine Romans of consular rank whom Plutarch counted as personal friends. This collegiality with Roman men of affairs says much about Plutarch's breadth and temperament. Not covetous of power himself, he felt at ease with those who were. He no doubt shared with them many dinner parties of the kind he represents in his table talk, where learned conversation flowed freely in Greek, for Plutarch learned Latin only late in life. At some point, probably when Plutarch was in his late 20s or early 30s, official business brought him to Rome, the first of several visits he would make over the next two decades. Greek intellectuals were highly sought after there as lecturers and moral preceptors, and Plutarch's talents soon gained him an audience. Important men, including Arulinus Rusticus, another future consul, listened as Plutarch discoursed in Greek on ethical topics. At Rome at this time, the teachings of Stoicism, and to a lesser degree Epicureanism, provided the dominant ethical models for upper-class intellectuals in search of the good life. But Plutarch preferred the less earthbound system devised by Plato and revised by his followers over the course of five intervening centuries. Indeed, several of his ethical writings take the form of dialogues in imitation of the works of Plato, or mount defenses of the Platonic system or attacks on rival schools. These philosophic dialogues and essays later got lumped together during the Middle Ages with Plutarch's various other non-biographical works, rhetorical exercises, antiquarian miscellanies, and personal reflections on family life, education, and proprieties of thought and behavior, into a vast collection called the Moralia. This anthology is just as voluminous as the Lives, and would be much larger if all of Plutarch's writings had survived. Evidence suggests that he wrote many more works than the 78 grouped today under the heading Moralia, a few of which are almost certainly the work of other unknown authors. It's an uneven collection, encompassing lively works that still bear close reading, along with others that today feel stale, stiff, or dated. But it has had enormous influence over time, providing a model for modern moral essayists, including Montaigne and Emerson. It's difficult to date any of Plutarch's writings absolutely or to establish their sequence, but it seems likely that most of the treatises in the Moralia precede the Parallel Lives. Indeed, one essay in the collection seems to show that while Plutarch had not yet begun writing biography, he was thinking about the ethical possibilities the genre offered. In a work that taught how to measure one's progress toward virtue, Plutarch tells his addressee, Senecio, that those striving for moral betterment should set before their eyes those who are good or who have been so, and ponder what would Plato have done in this situation. What would Epaminondas have said? How would Lycurgus or Agesilaus have appeared? And just as if looking in a mirror, compose themselves differently, or change some mode of speech that is unworthy of themselves, or resist some strong emotion. The thought and recollection of good men instantly comes to mind and keeps upright those striving toward virtue, preventing their falls. The passage seems to anticipate the project that still lay ahead for Plutarch, the Parallel Lives, especially when we consider that three of the four inspirational models here mentioned later became subjects of those lives, and one was probably the very first life Plutarch undertook. The paired lives of the Theban general Epaminondas and the Roman general Scipio once opened the collection of Parallel Lives, but these lives, along with at least one other pair, were lost in the work's transmission. The metaphor of biography as mirror, a reflecting medium by which one sees and improves oneself, was to become central to Plutarch as he progressed through the lives, and deeply personal. It figures prominently in the opening sentence of the Aemilius Paulus, a passage that comes as close as any to being a mission statement for the Lives as a whole. It first occurred to me to start the writing of Lives for the sake of other people, but now I stick to it and make myself at home there for my own sake, seeking by means of history to adorn myself, just as though looking in a mirror, and to make my life conform to the virtues of those men. Plutarch goes on in this prologue to describe his biographical subjects as dining companions, welcomed sequentially into his home and marveled at, as King Priam, in the final episode of Homer's Iliad, once marveled at the beauty and power of Achilles. I take from the deeds of each the principal and finest things that allow me to get to know them, Plutarch writes. Plutarch's focus on the finest things among the deeds of great men might suggest that the Lives supply only positive exemplars. But elsewhere, as in the prologue to Alexander, Plutarch speaks of the workings of virtue or vice, my emphasis, as the matter of his narratives. And indeed, Alexander was a creature of very mixed parts, as was Achilles. The Lives lean toward the positive in their portrayals of character and occasionally hide blemishes, but they are far from hagiographic, and their ranks include several figures Plutarch does not regard as admirable. Interestingly, the Lives of these anti-heroes, among the Greeks Alcibiades and among the Romans Mark Antony, are some of the longest and richest of Plutarch's compositions, revealing a deeper engagement on the part of the author than the more positive portraits. "Nothing touches man, but Plutarch feels it to be his," Emerson wrote in his introduction to the mid-19th century edition of Plutarch's works, overseen by his friend Arthur Hugh Clough. "He is tolerant even of vice, if he finds it genial." In his journals, Emerson quoted approvingly Clough's judgment that Antony, the portrait of a dissolute, reckless charmer, was the very finest of all the Lives. Plutarch had most likely returned to his native Chaeronea at the time he began the Lives, probably near the end of the 1st century CE, when he was about 50. He had read widely in both Greek and Roman history by that time, so as to draw on a wide array of primary sources, some precise and reliable, others gossipy and anecdotal. Plutarch's wide range of source materials, his lack of discrimination in borrowing from them, and his insouciance with regard to the chronology and relative weight of the events he describes, makes the study of the parallel Lives a frustrating pursuit for modern historians. But Plutarch never intended his work as a historical record. His own programmatic introduction to the Alexander serves, once again, as a valuable description of his technique. "I shall make no other preface than to entreat my readers not to object if I fail to present exhaustive descriptions of all the famous actions of these men, but offer, for the most part, abridged accounts of them. For it is not histories I am writing, but lives, and the most glorious deeds do not always reveal the workings of virtue or vice. Frequently a small thing, a phrase or a flash of wit, gives more insight into a man's character than battles where tens of thousands die, or vast arrays of troops or sieges of cities. Accordingly, just as painters derive their likenesses from a subject's face and the expression of his eyes, where character shows itself, and attach little importance to other parts of the body, so must I be allowed to give more attention to the manifestations of a man's soul, and thereby mould an image of his life." Plutarch would remain in Chaeronea the rest of his long life, serving the town as magistrate and the nearby shrine of Delphi as priest of Apollo. He married, and his wife Timoxena had at least 5 children, among them 4 sons and a daughter who died in childhood. The death prompted Plutarch to compose one of his most moving essays, A Consolation to His Wife. He lived through the reign of Trajan, Rome's most beloved and successful emperor since the time of Augustus, and into at least the first few years of that of Hadrian. By the time he died, around 120 CE, the Roman Empire was well into an era that Edward Gibbon famously termed the most happy and prosperous in the history of the world. Happy and prosperous, too, was the life he had led, a life rooted in study of the past, service to gods and mortals, and the quest for self-improvement through the contemplation of great historical figures, a quest he bequeathed to others by writing the parallel Lives. Modern listeners of Plutarch's Lives, however, are usually not seeking the moral self-improvement their author intended, but rather an immersion in the events of the classical past and an encounter with its greatest personalities. For this reason, nearly all recent editions of Plutarch's work, including the present one, have split up the paired lives and reorganized them into clusters to highlight different eras of history. This new scheme obscures the parallel part of the parallel lives and makes Plutarch's syncrises, the comparative essays with which he prefaced each pair of lives, highlighting the ways that the characters of their Greek and Roman subjects might illuminate each other, all but irrelevant. But it allows a fuller exploration of a single place, time, and culture, and a richer sense of the historical context that surrounds its subjects than the original paired arrangement. That historically informed reading is very much the experience our Age of Caesar seeks to provide. Plutarch's portraits of the five men included here show them to be emblematic of an era when force of character and personal ambition determined the fates of armies, nations, regimes. The conflicts that dominated the period play out in Plutarch's biographical scheme as contrasts in character, first between Julius Caesar and Pompey, two proud, stolid warriors striving to master the energies unleashed by Rome's expanding empire and increasingly professionalized armies, then between Caesar and Brutus, the first a restless man of action, the second a pensive philosopher-statesman driven to take up arms by forces beyond his control. Amid these clashes, Cicero and Antony pursued less fixed agendas, ending up on opposing sides and bound, for no inevitable reason, on a collision of their own. These two complex figures, Cicero, a politician always looking for self-advancement, and Antony, a soldier driven by his lusts for combat, pleasure, and finally, ruinously, for Cleopatra, seem to have intrigued Plutarch most deeply. Their quirks, and especially in Antony's case, flaws, render them vividly, appealingly human. In a wonderful historical overview of the late Roman Republic by Mary Beard, we hope to make modern listeners feel at home in the world of the first century BCE and allow them to follow Plutarch's biographies in close detail. It is hoped that their enjoyment of the five nearly contemporaneous lives contained herein, those of Pompey, Caesar, Cicero, Brutus, and Antony, will not often be impeded by questions of terminology and nomenclature, questions that so often pose a barrier between ourselves and the classical world. There is further justification for presenting these five lives in a single volume, detached from their Greek parallels. As historian Christopher Pelling has convincingly shown, four of the five, Cicero excluded, were composed by Plutarch at nearly the same time, based on a common set of source materials. Although the demonstrably earlier Cicero, we felt, had to be included because of its subject's historical importance, the remaining lives contained herein form a uniquely interconnected and unified set, bound together by frequent cross-references and by shared events and concerns. The lives of Cato the Younger and Marcus Licinius Crassus, which in Pelling's view may also have been part of this integrated project, were not selected for this volume, but the annotations highlight significant points where those lives overlap with or differ from the ones presented here. Among his many intellectual talents, Plutarch was a great prose stylist, and each new English version of his lives grapples with a challenge of his complex, highly structured Greek sentences. The team overseen by John Dryden in the late 17th century succeeded so admirably that their version remains in print today, though many of its idioms are now out of date, and the Greek text on which it was based has been revised by subsequent scholars. Pamela Mensch's translation takes a sounder Greek text as its foundation and brings Plutarch into line with modern usage, while still preserving much of the grace, solemnity, and elegance of the original. It is truly, we hope, a Plutarch for the 21st century. Emerson closed his introduction to Clough's edition of Plutarch in elegiac tones, foreseeing the enduring relevance of the author it enshrined. Plutarch's popularity will return in rapid cycles, he predicted. His sterling values will presently recall the eye and thought of the best minds, and his books will be reprinted and read anew by coming generations. and thus Plutarch will be perpetually rediscovered from time to time as long as books last. It is the hope of the editor and translator of this volume that, even if sterling values are no longer at the forefront of our presentation of Plutarch, the publication of Our Age of Caesar will help make Emerson a true prophet. Introduction. Mary Beard. The assassination of Julius Caesar on March 15, 44 BCE, the Ides of March by the Roman system of dating, is the most famous political murder in history. Caesar had recently been made dictator for life, and he was killed in the name of liberty by a group of men that he counted as friends and colleagues. In the aftermath, the assassins issued coins with a design specially chosen to celebrate the deed and press home the message. It featured the memorable date, Ide Mar, a pair of daggers, and the image of the small hat, the cap of liberty, regularly presented to Roman slaves when they were granted their freedom. This was liberation on a grander scale, freeing the Roman people from tyranny. All the characters whose biographies feature in this collection had some role in the story of the murder. Julius Caesar was the victim, his dying moments vividly described by Plutarch. In this account, there were no famous last words, et tu, Brute, or whatever. After a futile attempt to fight back, Caesar pulled his toga over his head and took the 23 dagger blows that killed him. Brutus was the leading figure behind the assassination, a frankly messy business, as Plutarch makes clear, with several of the assassins themselves caught in friendly fire, accidentally wounded by blows from their own side, and he was soon more or less forced to leave the city. Cicero, the Roman politician, philosopher, poet, wit, and orator, was not party to the plot, but was very likely an eyewitness of the murder, and was straightaway consulted by the assassins about what on earth to do next. One of their main problems was that they had not thought ahead. Antony was Caesar's right-hand man, gave the address at his funeral, and tried to take on the role of Caesar's defender and successor, though he soon found an even more powerful rival for that position. Pompey, with whom this collection opens, was already dead by 44. He had been killed 4 years earlier in a civil war, leading those Romans who had then been prepared to resort to pitched battles to resist the growing power of Caesar. But his shadow hung over the assassination. Caesar was murdered in an expensive new meeting hall whose building Pompey had funded, and he fell in front of a statue of Pompey himself, splattering it with his blood. It was as if Pompey was finally getting his revenge. The death of Caesar has provided the template for assassination ever since, and has been the focus of debate on the rights and wrongs of political violence. In 1865, John Wilkes Booth used the word Ides as the code word for the planned date of the assassination of President Lincoln. Shakespeare, in his Julius Caesar, largely drawing on an early translation of Plutarch's biography, used the events of 44 BCE to reflect on the nature of political power, ideology, and moral conscience. Others have seen the assassination as a useful reminder of the futility of such attempts at direct action. For what did it achieve? If the assassins had really wanted to quash the rise of one-man rule in Rome, if they wanted to kill the tyranny as well as the tyrant, they were strikingly unsuccessful. More than a decade of civil war followed, a major theme in Plutarch's biographies of Brutus and Antony. But the end result was that Caesar's great-nephew, Augustus, as he was later known, the man who rivaled Antony as Caesar's heir, became the first Roman emperor. He established autocratic rule on a permanent basis. So much for the return of liberty. In the long history of Rome, founded, as the Romans themselves calculated it, around 750 BCE, the murder of Caesar, for all its later notoriety, was just one of many political crises that became particularly intense and violent in the 2nd and 1st centuries BCE. This was a period of expansion, political change, even revolution. It saw vast Roman conquests overseas and, as a consequence, an enormous influx of wealth into the city. Gleaming marble from Greece rather than local brick and stone now began to be used for temples and other public buildings in the city. Captive slaves started to make up the majority of the workforce, and so many people flocked to Rome that its population topped 1 million, the only Western city of that size until London in the early 19th century. But this age also saw repeated outbreaks of civil war at home, political disintegration, mass pogroms of citizens, and the final fracture of what had once been a more or less democratic system of government. As a leading politician, Caesar was almost typical in coming to a violent end. None of the men featured in this book died in their beds, nor fighting some barbarian enemy. They were killed in conflict with other Romans, by Roman hands or on Roman orders. Pompey, for example, after losing in battle to Caesar, was decapitated by an Egyptian eunuch, ably assisted by a couple of Roman veteran soldiers. Cicero was put to death in 43 BCE in one of the pogroms, on Antony's instructions, his head and hands later pinned up in the center of Rome as macabre trophies for the crowds to leer and jeer. A little over a decade later, Antony ended up killing himself after he had lost in battle to Caesar's great-nephew and successor. The Romans described and fiercely debated the stresses and breakdown of their political system, trailing all kinds of explanations and possible solutions. For this period was also one of intellectual revolution at Rome, when the rich tradition of Roman literature began. Starting in the early 2nd century BCE, Roman writers for the first time tried to tell the history of their city, to reflect on its problems and on how they thought it should be governed. And they used writing too for political attacks, insults in verse, self-advertisement in public, and for personal letters in which they shared their aspirations, fears, and suspicions. When Plutarch in the early 2nd century CE was writing these biographies, he could base his narrative on plenty of contemporary material from the age of Caesar. Some of this we can still read, including Caesar's own one-sided account of his campaigns against the tribes of Gaul and later against Pompey, one of the very few eyewitness descriptions of ancient warfare to have come down to us, and volumes of Cicero's political speeches, philosophical treatises, and hundreds of his private letters made public after his death by his loyal heirs. This writing helps us to understand what underlay all that chaos. The rapid growth of the Roman Empire was one crucial and destabilizing factor. For us, why Rome grew in a few centuries from a small, moderately successful town in central Italy to one with control over more of Europe and the Mediterranean world than any state before or since is one of history's big puzzles. Most modern observers put it down to some unfathomable combination of greed, a highly militaristic ideology, a dose of good luck, and a happy knack of converting those they conquered into Roman citizens, and so into new soldiers for the Roman cause. The Romans themselves were less puzzled on this score, pointing to the support of the gods, their own piety, and a succession of defensive rather than aggressive wars in which they intervened to protect allies under threat. They were more troubled by the consequences of overseas growth for society and politics back home. Despite their popular modern image, Romans were not simply thoughtless and jingoistic imperialists. Some worried that the wealth and luxury which came with conquest overseas undermined what they saw as old-fashioned, tough Roman austerity. A few about the cruelty of conquest. There was even one, perhaps not entirely serious, proposal to put Caesar on trial for genocide during his conquest of Gaul. Others faced the question of how to adapt the traditional structures of Roman government to cope with new imperial demands. For how could you control and defend a vast empire stretching from Spain to Syria with a power structure and a system of military command developed to run nothing more than a small town? That was one of the big issues behind the revolutionary changes of this period, and one of the factors that promoted the rise of dynasts such as Caesar. The political traditions of Rome, at least as far back to the end of the 6th century BCE, had been based on the principle that power was only ever held on a temporary basis and was always shared. The citizens as a whole elected the city's officials, who combined both military and civilian duties, held office for just 1 year at a time, ideally not to be repeated, and never had fully independent decision-making power. The fact that there had always been not one but two consuls, the most senior of these annual officials, is a clear sign of that long-established commitment to power-sharing. But it was a principle ill-suited to governing a far-flung empire and to fighting wars that might take place several months' distance from Italy. You could hardly travel there and back in the regular year of office. The Romans improvised various solutions to that problem, sending men out to the provinces, for example, after their year of office in Rome. But increasingly, the Roman people voted more and more power into the hands of ambitious individual politicians on an almost permanent basis, even though those votes were often controversial and sometimes violently resisted. Caesar was not the first to challenge the traditional model of power sharing. Despite leading the traditionalists against Caesar in 49 BCE, Pompey himself had, only 15 years or so earlier, been granted unlimited power for years on end across the whole of the eastern Mediterranean, first to deal with the pirates and human traffickers operating on the sea, then to deal with one of Rome's remaining enemies in the east, King Mithridates of Pontus, in modern Turkey. Cicero was one of those who successfully spoke up, in a speech whose text we can still read, to quell the opposition to this grant, which saw it as a dangerous step in the direction of one-man rule. Even Brutus, despite his fine slogans on the subject of liberty, seems not to have been entirely immune from similar dreams of personal power. The coins celebrating Caesar's assassination may have displayed the daggers and cap of liberty on one side, but on the other was an image of the head of Brutus himself. In Roman eyes, heads of living people on coins smacked of autocratic ambitions. Caesar was the first to risk such a display at Rome, Brutus the second. So one side of the age of Caesar, richly documented in Plutarch's Lives, was a series of big men, bankrolled by the vast profits that followed imperial conquests, competing for personal power. And that competition often came down to open fighting, whether in the streets of Rome itself, where there was no police force or any form of peacekeepers to maintain order, or across the empire more widely. The final battle in the Roman civil war between Caesar and Pompey was fought in northern Greece, and Pompey himself was brutally finished off on the coast of Egypt. As the coin of Brutus hints, the murder of Caesar came simply too late to put the clock back to old-fashioned power-sharing. If Augustus had not established permanent one-man rule, Antony or some other rival would surely have done so. Another important side of the period were the increasingly intense debates about what we would call civil liberties. How was it possible to protect the rights of the individual Roman citizen in this violent turmoil? How were the rights of citizenship to be balanced against the safety of the state itself? This came to a head almost 20 years before Caesar's assassination in 63 BCE. As Plutarch and others described it, Cicero was consul and believed that he had uncovered a terrorist plot masterminded by a bankrupt and desperate aristocrat named Catiline to eliminate some of the leading politicians, Cicero included, and to burn down much of the city. Once he had frightened Catiline out of Rome, Cicero rounded up those he believed were his accomplices and had them all executed without trial, even though they were Roman citizens and, as such, had a right to due legal process. Vixere, they have lived, that is, they are dead, he said in a particularly chilling euphemism as he left the jail after supervising the execution. Not everyone at the time approved. Caesar was one who objected, combining, as many have since, aspirations for dictatorship with a strong sense of popular justice. But in general, Cicero was hailed as a hero who had saved the state from destruction. The popularity did not, however, last for long. Despite claiming the protection of an ancient equivalent of a Prevention of Terrorism Act, Cicero was soon banished into exile on the charge of executing citizens without trial. He was recalled within a few months, but during his absence, his house had been demolished and a shrine to the goddess Liberty had pointedly been erected on the site. The rights and wrong of this case were debated ever after. How far, the Romans wondered, were elected officials allowed or obliged to transcend the law to save the state? as we now debate exactly how far the interests of homeland security make it legitimate to suspend the rights and protection that citizenship ought to offer, this is one of the cause celebre that speaks to us most directly. The age of Caesar, then, was a world of political murder, street violence, constant warfare both inside and outside Rome, and fundamental disagreements about how the state should be run, how democracy and liberty might be preserved, while the demands of empire and security were met. It is impossible not to wonder what it was actually like to live through, and not just for the elite, rich, and male political leaders who were the leading characters and celebrity victims in the dramatic conflicts and the focus of all ancient writers. What of the ordinary men and women who were not in the limelight? Did life for them go on much as before, while the big men and their armies fought it out? Or did the violence and bloodshed touch almost everyone? It is hard to know, and wrong to generalize. Just occasionally, Plutarch does take his eyes off those at the very top of the pile and throw a fleeting glance at ordinary people carrying on with their lives more or less as usual in the chaos around them. We meet in passing Cicero's wives and his daughter, Tullia, who, like so many women in the Roman world, died from complications of childbirth, along with her infant son. We have a glimpse of an enterprising trader from North Italy, a man called Petitius, who in 48 BCE just happened to be traveling in his ship along the coast of Greece when he spotted Pompey on the run after his defeat by Caesar and gave him a lift south. And most engaging of all, thanks to information he had picked up from his grandfather, Plutarch gives us a tiny but vivid insight into the practices below stairs in the kitchens of the palace in Alexandria that, to the horror of many Romans, Antony eventually came to share with Queen Cleopatra. Apparently, the cooks were so concerned about preparing the wild boar to perfection whenever the company upstairs decided to eat that they had 8 boars roasting, each put on to cook at a different time, so that one would be sure to be just right when dinner was summoned. It is a nice image of ordinary people living in their own world and dealing in their own way with, and maybe laughing at, the capricious demands of the world leaders they served. But not all were so lucky. One memorable story told by Plutarch, repeated and made even more famous by Shakespeare in his Julius Caesar, tells the fate of an unfortunate poet called Cinna. This man was not quite as ordinary as Petitius or the cooks in Alexandria. He was actually a friend of Caesar, but he was not in the political mainstream. A couple of days after the assassination, he went to the Forum to see his friend laid out for his funeral and fell in with a crowd of Caesar's mourning and angry supporters. These men mistook the poet for a different Cinna, a man who had been one of the assassins, and so tore the poor man limb from limb. The message of the story is clear. Assassinations have innocent victims, too. Simple cases of mistaken identity, and there must have been many of those at Rome in the absence of any form of official ID, can leave a blameless bystander dead. Shakespeare's plaintive line, "I am Cinna the poet! I am Cinna the poet!" is a haunting reminder of the many who must have been caught in the crossfire when the leaders of the Roman world clashed. Pompey. The Roman people seem to have entertained for Pompey from the very start the same feeling the Prometheus of Aeschylus expresses for Heracles when, after being saved by him, he says, "Most dear to me this child, whose father I hate." For the Romans had never harbored a hatred so powerful and savage for any of their generals as they did for Strabo, the father of Pompey. While he lived, they feared his power in arms, for he was a consummate warrior, but when he died, struck by a thunderbolt, and his body was being carried out for burial, they dragged it from the bier and showered it with insults. Yet no Roman has enjoyed a deeper goodwill, or one that sprang up sooner or reached a greater height when he was prospering, or abided so constantly when he had stumbled, than Pompey. And whereas there was only one cause of their hatred for Strabo, namely his insatiable avarice, there were many reasons for their adoration of Pompey. His temperate way of life, his military training, his persuasive speech, the trustworthiness of his character, and his affability when meeting people, since no one asked a favor with less offense or bestowed one with more grace. For in addition to his other talents, he had the ability to give without oppressing and to receive without losing his dignity. 2. In his youth, his handsome looks won him great popularity and captivated his hearers even before he spoke. His beauty as a boy had something in it of benevolence and dignity, and in the prime of his manhood, the majesty and kingliness of his character at once became visible in it. His hair rose in a slight wave from his forehead, and this, with the flickering motion of his eyes, created a resemblance, more talked of than really apparent, to the statues of King Alexander. And for this reason many applied that name to him in his youth. Pompey himself did not decline it, so that some called him Alexander in mockery. And therefore Lucius Philippus, a man of consular rank, when he was pleading in favor of him, said he was doing nothing unusual if, being a Philip, he was fond of Alexander. It is related of Flora the courtesan that when she was quite old, she always liked to recall her former intimacy with Pompey, and used to say that she never went away after sleeping with him without bearing the mark of his bite. She would also describe how Geminius, one of Pompey's companions, fell in love with her and pestered her greatly with his attentions. And when she explained that she had to refuse him because of Pompey, Geminius took the matter up with him. Pompey, accordingly, turned her over to Geminius and never afterward consorted with her, though he was thought to have a passion for her. And she herself did not bear this treatment in the manner of a courtesan, but was ill for a considerable time from grief and longing. This Flora, they say, bloomed into such beauty that when Cecilius Metellus was adorning the temple of Castor and Pollux with statues and paintings, he included her portrait among his votive offerings. In his conduct also with the wife of Demetrius, his freedman, who had great influence with him and left an estate of 4,000 talents, Pompey acted, contrary to his usual habits, not fairly or generously, fearing that he might appear to be vanquished by her beauty, which was irresistible and widely spoken of. But though he was extremely circumspect and guarded, yet even in matters of this nature he did not escape the censures of his enemies, but was accused of affairs with married women, for whose gratification he is said to have neglected and compromised many public interests. With regard to his simplicity and plainness in eating and drinking, the following story is told. Once, when he was ill and nauseated by food, a physician prescribed him a thrush to eat. But when his servants, on searching, found none for sale, for they were not then in season, and someone said they could be found at the house of Lucullus, since he kept them all year round, Pompey asked, "So if Lucullus were not luxurious, Pompey could not live?" And disregarding the physician, he took something that could easily be procured. But this was at a later time. 3. While he was still a very young man, and serving in an expedition that his father was commanding against Cinna, he had a certain Lucius Terentius as a companion and tentmate. This man, bribed by Cinna, was himself going to kill Pompey, while others were to set fire to Strabo's tent. Pompey was informed of this conspiracy while at supper. He was not at all disconcerted, but on the contrary drank more freely than usual and expressed great affection for Terentius. But when he had retired to rest, he slipped out of his tent unnoticed, set a guard about his father, and quietly awaited the outcome. Terentius, when he thought the right moment had come, rose with his drawn sword, came to Pompey's couch, and stabbed many times through the bedclothes, as if Pompey were lying there. After this, there was a great uproar arising from the hatred felt towards Strabo, and an impulse to revolt on the part of the soldiers, who tore down their tents and took up their weapons. The general, fearing the tumult, did not come forward, but Pompey, going about among the soldiers, entreated them with tears, and finally threw himself face down before the gate of the camp and lay in their way, weeping and bidding those who were marching off to trample on him. At this, everyone drew back out of shame, and all except 800 changed their minds and were reconciled to the general. 4. As soon as Strabo was dead, Pompey, as his heir, was put on trial for his father's embezzlement of public property. And though Pompey discovered that most of the thefts had been perpetrated by a certain Alexander, a freedman of his father's, and proved this to the magistrates, he himself was accused of having in his possession some hunting nets and books that were taken at Asculum. These items Pompey had indeed received from his father when Strabo took Asculum, but he had lost them when, on Cinna's return to Rome, Pompey's house was broken into and plundered by Cinna's guards. In this trial, he made many preparatory pleadings against his accuser, in which he showed an astuteness and composure beyond his years, and gained great reputation and favor. As a result, Antistius, the praetor and judge in the case, took a great liking to him and offered him his daughter in marriage, and conferred with friends about it. Pompey accepted the proposal, and a private contract was drawn up. But the people came to know of it from the trouble Antistius took to favor Pompey. And finally, when Antistius announced that the judges had voted to acquit, the people, as if a signal had been given, shouted out, "For Thalassius," the ancient and traditional acclamation at marriages. The custom is said to have this origin. At the time when the daughters of the Sabines came to Rome to see a spectacle of games, and were abducted by the most distinguished and bravest of the Romans to be their wives, certain laborers and herdsmen of obscure rank were carrying off a tall and beautiful girl. And lest any of their superiors should meet them and take her away, they cried out, "For Thalassius," as they ran, Thalassius being a well-known and popular figure, so that everyone who heard the name clapped their hands and joined them in the shout, as if they were rejoicing and commending what they were doing. Now, they say, because the marriage proved a fortunate one for Thalassius, this acclamation is used humorously as a nuptial greeting at weddings. This is the most plausible of the accounts given about Thalassius. In any event, a few days after the trial, Pompey married Antistia. 5. Then he went to Cinna's camp, but alarmed by some false accusation, he quickly departed unnoticed. His disappearance excited suspicion, and a rumor spread through the camp that Cinna had murdered the young man. Then all who had long resented and hated Cinna resolved to go after him. Cinna, trying to flee, was seized by one of the centurions, who pursued him with his drawn sword, whereupon Cinna, falling upon his knees, offered the man his seal ring, an object of great value. But the centurion, retorting insolently, said, "I have not come to seal a guarantee, but to punish a lawless and abominable tyrant," and slew him. Cinna, having died in this way, Carbo, a tyrant even more unstable, received and exercised the supreme command. But Sulla was approaching, to the joy and satisfaction of most people, who in their present plight considered a change of masters no small comfort. To such a pass had the city been brought by its misfortunes that, in despair of liberty, it sought only a more tolerable servitude. 6. At that time Pompey was in Picenum in Italy, as he had estates there, though the greater motive of his stay was the liking he felt for the towns in that district, which were affectionately and kindly disposed toward him as his father's son. But when he saw that the noblest and best of the citizens were forsaking their homes and hastening from all sides to Sulla's camp as to a haven, he himself did not think it right to go to Sulla as a fugitive, or with nothing to offer, or requesting his help. Instead, he should first confer some favor in a way that would gain him honor and arrive at the head of a body of troops. He therefore solicited the people of Picenum for their assistance. They gladly listened to him and paid no heed to the messengers sent from Carbo. In fact, when a certain Vedius said that Pompey had jumped straight from pedagogy into demagogy, they were so incensed that they fell at once upon Vedius and killed him. After this, Pompey, though he was only 23 and had not been appointed general by anyone, conferred the command upon himself. Setting up a tribunal in the marketplace of Oximum, a large city, he issued a public edict ordering the chief men, two brothers named Ventidius, who were acting against him in Carbo's interest, to leave the city. He then proceeded to levy soldiers, and after issuing commissions to centurions and other officers in proper form, he went around to the other cities, doing the same thing. All of Carbo's partisans yielded and withdrew, and everyone else cheerfully offered Pompey his services, so that in a little while he had mustered 3 entire legions and supplied them with food, baggage, wagons, carriages, and other necessities of war. Then he advanced towards Sulla, not as if he were in a hurry or eager to avoid detection, but halting often on the way to harass the enemy, and doing what he could to wrest from Carbo's control all the Italian territory through which he passed. 7. 3 enemy commanders, Carinus, Cleelius, and Brutus, encountered him at the same time, not all head-on or from a single direction, but surrounding him with 3 armies in order to overwhelm him. Pompey, however, was not alarmed, but collected all his troops into one body and hastened against the army of Brutus, having stationed his horsemen, among whom he rode, at the head of his forces. And when from the enemy's side the Celtic horsemen rode out to meet him, he himself fought hand to hand with the first and strongest of them, struck him with his spear, and brought him down. The others then turned and fled, threw their own infantry into confusion, and caused a general rout. After this, the opposing generals, quarrelling among themselves, retired as best they could, and the cities came over to Pompey, thinking that the enemy had dispersed out of fear. Next, Scipio the consul came to attack him, but before their front ranks were within range of each other's javelins, Scipio's soldiers saluted Pompey and came over to him, and Scipio took to flight. Finally, Carbo himself sent many troops of horsemen against him by the river Arsis. Resisting them stoutly, Pompey routed them, and in the pursuit forced them onto difficult ground, unsuitable for horses, where, seeing no hope of escape, they surrendered to him with their armor and horses. 8. Sulla had not yet learned of these actions, but at the first news and reports grew anxious about Pompey, engaged as he was with so many and such experienced enemy generals, and hastened to his aid. But when Pompey learned that Sulla was near, he ordered his officers to get their men fully armed and draw them up in array, that they might make the finest and most splendid appearance before the imperator. For he expected great honors from him, and met with even greater. For when Sulla saw him advancing with a remarkable army of brave young men, their spirits elated and encouraged by their successes, he sprang from his horse, and after being saluted, as was proper, with the title of imperator, he in turn saluted Pompey as imperator, though no one would have expected Sulla to address a young man, and one who was not yet a senator, with a title that was the object of contention between him and the Scipios and Marii. And all the rest of his behaviour was in keeping with these first friendly gestures. He would rise to his feet when Pompey approached, and uncover his head, things he was rarely seen doing with anyone else, though there were many worthy men about him. Yet Pompey was not puffed up by these things, and when Sulla would have sent him at once into Gaul, a province in which it was thought Metellus, who commanded there, was doing nothing worthy of the large forces at his disposal, he said it was not right for him to take a province out of the hands of his senior in command and his superior in reputation. But if Metellus were willing, and ordered him to do so, he was prepared to assist him in the war. And when Metellus accepted the proposal and wrote to him to come, he immediately hastened into Gaul, where he achieved wonderful exploits by himself, and fired up and rekindled that bold and warlike spirit that old age was now extinguishing in Metellus, just as molten bronze, when poured upon that which is rigid and cold, is said to dissolve and melt it down faster than fire itself. But just as an athlete who has gained the first place among men, and carried away the prizes at all the games, takes no account of his victories as a boy and leaves them unrecorded, so it is with the exploits of Pompey at that time, though they were extraordinary in themselves. But because they have been buried in the multitude and greatness of his later wars and contests, I am afraid to recur to them, lest by spending too much time on the deeds of his youth, I leave no room for those actions and experiences that were greatest and that best illustrate his character. 9. When Sulla had gained control of Italy and was proclaimed dictator, he began to reward the rest of his officers and generals by making them rich, advancing them to offices, and granting them freely and without reservation any favors they requested. And as he admired Pompey's integrity and thought the man might be of great use to him in his affairs, Sulla was eager to attach him to himself by some family relationship. His wife Metella sharing his wishes, they persuaded Pompey to divorce Antistia and marry Aemilia, Sulla's stepdaughter, Metella's daughter by Scaurus, though she already had a husband and was expecting a child. This marriage, accordingly, was a product of tyranny and suited the advantage of Sulla rather than the character and habits of Pompey, Aemilia being given to him in marriage when pregnant by another, and Antistia being driven away with dishonor and misery by him, for whose sake she had recently been deprived of her father. For Antistius had been murdered in the Senate House because he was suspected of favoring Sulla for Pompey's sake, and Antistia's mother, on witnessing these outrageous acts, had committed suicide. Hence this misfortune was added to the tragedy of that marriage, and as the crowning blow, Aemilia, as soon as she entered Pompey's house, died in childbirth. 10. After this, news came to Sulla that Perpenna was taking possession of Sicily and making the island a refuge for the survivors of the opposition party, that Carbo was hovering about those seas with a fleet, that Domitius had invaded Africa, and that many other prominent exiles were flocking there, as many as had managed to escape his prescriptions. Against these men, Pompey was sent with a large force. Perpenna immediately abandoned Sicily to him. Pompey received its distressed cities and treated all of them, except the Mamertines in Messene, with great kindness. When they deprecated his court and jurisdiction, alleging that these were forbidden by an ancient Roman law, Pompey replied, "Will you not stop quoting laws to us who have our swords by our sides?" He was also thought to have treated the unfortunate Carbo with an inhuman insolence. For if there had been a necessity, as perhaps there was, to put the man to death, it should have been done as soon as he was seized, for then it would have been the act of the man who ordered it. But here Pompey commanded a man who had been 3 times consul to be brought in shackles to stand before the rostrum, where he himself was sitting in judgment, and interrogated him closely to the distress and indignation of the audience. Then he ordered him to be led away and put to death. It is also reported that when Carbo had been led to the place of execution and saw the sword already drawn, he asked that a convenient place and a brief time might be afforded him, as his bowels were giving him trouble. And Gaius Oppius, the friend of Caesar, says that Pompey also dealt cruelly with Quintus Valerius, a man known to be of exceptional learning and science. For when Valerius was brought to him, Pompey drew him aside and walked up and down with him, asked and learned what he wished to know, and then ordered his officers to lead him away and put him to death. But whenever Oppius speaks about the enemies or friends of Caesar, we must not be too credulous. Pompey was compelled to punish those enemies of Sulla who were especially eminent and whose capture was common knowledge. As for the rest, he let as many as possible escape detection, and even helped some to get away. When, for example, he had decided to punish the city of Himera, which had sided with the enemy, Sthenis, the city's popular leader, asked Pompey for an audience and said he would be acting unjustly if he let the guilty party go and destroyed the innocent. And when Pompey asked him whom he meant by the guilty party, Sthenis said he meant himself, since he had persuaded his friends and forced his enemies to do as they had done. Delighted with the frankness and spirit of the man, Pompey pardoned him first and then all the others. Furthermore, when he learned that his soldiers were disorderly in their journeys, he put a seal upon their swords, and whoever broke the seal was punished. 11. While attending to these matters and arranging the affairs of Sicily, he received a decree from the Senate and a letter from Sulla ordering him to sail to Africa to make war upon Domitius with all his forces. For Domitius had mustered an army many times larger than that with which Marius, not long before, had crossed from Africa into Italy and caused a revolution in Rome, making himself a tyrant instead of an exile. Pompey, accordingly, after making all his preparations with the utmost speed, left Memmius, his sister's husband, as governor of Sicily, while he himself set sail with 120 warships and 800 transports, carrying provisions, weapons, money, and siege engines. When he had landed with part of his fleet at Utica and with part at Carthage, 7,000 of the enemy revolted and came over to him. The forces that he brought with him consisted of 6 entire legions. Something absurd is reported to have happened to him then. Some of his soldiers, it would seem, having stumbled upon a treasure, got a good sum of money. When the incident became public, the rest of the army began to imagine that the place was full of money that had been hidden there by the Carthaginians at some time of misfortune. Accordingly, Pompey was unable for many days to do anything with his soldiers, who were engaged in hunting for treasure. He himself went about laughing to see so many thousands of men digging and turning up the earth. Finally, abandoning their search, they urged Pompey to lead them where he pleased, declaring that they had been punished enough for their folly. 12. Domitius had drawn up his army against Pompey, but there was a ravine between them, craggy and hard to cross. At the same time, a great storm of wind and rain had been pouring down since morning, so that he gave up all thought of fighting that day and commanded his troops to retreat. But Pompey, who had been watching for this opportunity, quickly advanced and crossed the ravine. The enemy was in great confusion and disorder, and not all of them were there, nor did they resist with any uniformity, and the wind, having shifted, drove the rain full in their faces. The Romans were also troubled by the storm, since they could not see one another clearly, and Pompey himself, not being recognized, narrowly escaped death. For when one of the soldiers asked him for the password, he was somewhat slow to answer. But having routed the enemy with a great slaughter, for they say that of 20,000 only 3,000 escaped, they hailed Pompey as imperator. And when he said he could not accept that title as long as the camp of the enemy was standing, but that if they thought to make him worthy of the honor they must first demolish that, they instantly assaulted the fortifications. And there Pompey fought without his helmet, in fear of his former danger. The camp was thus taken, and Domitius perished. Then some of the cities surrendered at once, and the others were taken by storm. Pompey also captured King Iarbas, a confederate of Domitius, and gave his kingdom to Hiempsal. Taking advantage of the good fortune and impetus of his army, he invaded Numidia. He advanced through the country for many days, conquering all whom he encountered, and revived the barbarians' fear of the Roman power, which had all but faded away. He even said that the wild beasts of Africa should not be left without some experience of the courage and strength of the Romans. Accordingly, he spent a few days hunting lions and elephants, and it is said that it took him only 40 days, all told, to overthrow his enemies, subdue Africa, and settle the affair of its kings, though he was then only 24 years old. 13. On his return to Utica, a letter was brought to him from Sulla, ordering him to dismiss the rest of his army, but to remain there himself with one legion and await the general who was to succeed him. Pompey himself did not let on how distressed he was at this order, but his soldiers resented it openly. And when Pompey begged them to go home ahead of him, they began to malign Sulla and declared that they refused to forsake their general and urged him not to trust the tyrant. At first, Pompey tried to soothe and pacify them, but when he could not persuade them, he descended from the rostrum and departed to his tent in tears. Then his soldiers seized him and set him again on the rostrum, where a great part of the day was spent in dispute, his men pressing him to remain and command them, and he entreating them to obey and not to mutiny. At last, when they grew even more importunate and clamorous, he swore he would kill himself if they attempted to force him, and even then they scarcely desisted. The first news that reached Sulla was that Pompey had revolted. Sulla told his friends it was his fate to contend with children in his old age, for Marius too, who was a very young man, had given him a great deal of trouble and involved him in the utmost danger. But when he learned the truth and saw everyone rushing forth to welcome Pompey and accompany him home with great affection, he was eager to outdo them. He therefore went out ahead to meet him, and after embracing him with great cordiality, hailed him in a loud voice as Magnus, which means the great, and ordered those who were present to call him by that name. Others, however, say that this title was first given him in Africa by the whole army, but acquired authority and weight by Sulla's confirmation. Pompey himself was the last of all to use it, for it was a long time after, when he was sent as proconsul against Sertorius, that he began to sign his letters and decrees Pompeius Magnus, since by then the name had become familiar and no longer excited envy. One should therefore respect and admire the ancient Romans, who did not bestow such titles and surnames as a reward for successful wars and commands only, but also adorned the achievements and virtues of their statesmen with the same tokens of honor. In two instances, at any rate, the people bestowed the title Maximus, which means the greatest, upon Valerius for reconciling the Senate and people, and upon Fabius Rullus because he expelled from the Senate certain descendants of freedmen who had been enrolled in it on account of their wealth. 14. Pompey now asked for a triumph, but Sulla turned him down, for the law granted that honor to a consul or praetor only, and to no one else. And therefore Scipio the Elder, who had subdued the Carthaginians in Spain in far greater and nobler contests, did not request a triumph, for he was not a consul nor even a praetor. And if Pompey, who had scarcely yet grown a beard and was not of age to be a senator, entered the city in triumph, it would render Sulla's government and Pompey's honor altogether obnoxious. This was what Sulla said to Pompey, declaring that he would not grant his request, but would oppose him and thwart his ambition if he refused to obey him. Pompey, however, did not cower, but urged Sulla to bear in mind that more people worshipped the rising than the setting sun, implying that his own power was increasing and Sulla's on the wane. Sulla did not hear the words perfectly, but seeing from their looks and gestures that those who had heard him were amazed, he asked what he had said. When he learned what it was, he was shocked at Pompey's boldness and cried out twice in succession, "Let him triumph!" And when many were offended and displeased with him, Pompey, wishing all the more to annoy them, tried to drive into the city on a chariot drawn by four elephants, for he had brought several from Africa that he had captured from its kings. But since the gates of the city were too narrow, he gave up the idea and switched to his horses. And when his soldiers, who had not received the rewards they had expected, wanted to make trouble and raise a rumpus, Pompey said he could hardly care less and would rather dispense with the triumph than flatter them. At this, Servilius, a man of great distinction who had been most opposed to Pompey's triumph, said he now saw that Pompey was truly great and worthy of a triumph. It is clear that Pompey might easily have become a senator at the time, had he wished it, but he was not eager for that, since he was ambitious, as they say, only for honors that were distinctive. For it would not have been surprising for Pompey to serve in the Senate before he was of age, whereas it was exceptionally glorious for him to celebrate a triumph before he was a senator. And this did much to endear him to the people, who were delighted that after a triumph he was still classed among the knights. 15. Sulla, however, was displeased at seeing to what a height of renown and power Pompey was advancing. But being ashamed to hinder him, he kept quiet, except, that is, when by force and against his wishes Pompey made Lepidus consul, having campaigned for him and got the people to support him by the goodwill they felt for himself. On that occasion, seeing Pompey go off with a crowd through the forum, Sulla said, "I see, young man, that you rejoice in your victory. For how could it not be a fine and noble thing for Lepidus, the worst of men, to be made consul in preference to Catulus, the best in the city, and all through your influence with the people? Yet you would do well to keep awake and look to your interests, for you have made your enemy stronger than yourself." But the clearest proof that Sulla was not well disposed to Pompey was in his will. For though he bequeathed gifts to other friends and appointed others as guardians of his son, he wholly overlooked Pompey. Yet Pompey bore this with great moderation and tact, so much so that when Lepidus and some others tried to prevent the body of Sulla from being buried in the Campus Martius, or even from receiving a public funeral, Pompey came to the rescue and saw to it that the rites were performed with all honor and security. 16. Shortly after the death of Sulla, the man's prophetic words were fulfilled, and Lepidus tried to thrust himself into Sulla's position. taking no roundabout route, resorting to no pretense, but immediately appearing in arms, he once again roused and gathered about him all the ailing remnants of the factions that had escaped the hand of Sulla. His colleague Catulus, who was followed by the incorrupt and sounder part of the Senate and people, was the man the Romans then held in the highest esteem for wisdom and justice, but he was thought better suited to political than military leadership. The crisis required Pompey, who was not long in deciding how to proceed. Attaching himself to the nobility, he was appointed commander of the army against Lepidus, who had already stirred up a great part of Italy and was holding Cisalpine Gaul with an army under Brutus. As for the rest of Lepidus' garrisons, Pompey subdued them with ease, but at Mutina in Gaul he lay a long time encamped against Brutus. In the meantime, Lepidus marched in haste to Rome and, besieging it, demanded a second consulship and terrified the citizens with a throng of followers. But their fear vanished when a letter brought from Pompey announced that he had ended the war without a battle. For Brutus, either betraying his army or being betrayed when it revolted, surrendered himself to Pompey, and receiving an escort of horsemen, retired to a little town on the Po, where he was slain the next day by Geminius in obedience to Pompey's order. And for this Pompey was severely censured. For at the beginning of the revolt he had written to the Senate that Brutus had voluntarily surrendered himself, and then he sent other letters denouncing the man after he had been slain. The Brutus, who with Cassius slew Caesar, was a son of this Brutus, and was like his father neither in war nor in his death, as is written in his life. Lepidus, as soon as he was banished from Italy, crossed to Sardinia, and there he fell ill and died of sorrow, not for his public misfortunes, as they say, but upon the accidental discovery of a letter proving that his wife had been unfaithful to him. 17. But there remained Sertorius, a general very different from Lepidus, in possession of Spain, and posing a formidable threat to the Romans. Into this man, as if for a final disease, the evils of the civil wars had now poured. He had already slain many of the inferior commanders, and was at this time engaged against Metellus Pius, a distinguished man and a good soldier, though he was now thought too slow, by reason of his age, to follow up the opportunities of the war, and likely to be found wanting in the rough and tumble of events. For Sertorius attacked him impetuously, like a bandit, and by ambushes and flanking movements confused a man who was used to conventional combat, and who commanded stationary and heavy armed troops. Pompey, therefore, who kept his army under his command, made it his object to be sent out to assist Metellus, and though Catulus ordered him to disband his forces, Pompey would not do so, but remained in arms near the city, always making some excuse or other, until the Senate, on Lucius Philippus' motion, gave him the command. It was on that occasion, they say, that when one of the senators asked with amazement whether Philippus thought Pompey should be sent out as proconsul, Philippus replied, "No, indeed, but as proconsuls," implying that both consuls for that year were utterly useless. 18. When Pompey arrived in Spain, as is usual when a new commander is famous, he inspired the men with hopes, and those nations that were not firmly tied to Sertorius began to waver and change their allegiance. At this, Sertorius made various arrogant speeches disparaging Pompey, and mockingly remarked that he would have needed only a cane and whip for the boy, if he were not afraid of the old woman, meaning Metellus. But in fact he kept a close and wary eye on Pompey, and conducted the campaign more cautiously than before. For Metellus, to everyone's surprise, had become extremely luxurious in his way of life, and had given himself up completely to his pleasures. Indeed, there had been a great and sudden change in his attitude toward ostentation and extravagance. And this very thing gained Pompey a marvellous goodwill and reputation, since he had always maintained a simplicity in his way of life, though this entailed no great sacrifice, for he was naturally temperate and restrained in his desires. The war had various phases, but nothing annoyed Pompey so much as the capture of the city of Lauron by Sertorius. For when Pompey thought he had him surrounded, and had boasted somewhat about it, it suddenly appeared that he himself was surrounded. As a result, he was afraid to move and had to watch while the city was burned before his eyes. But later, in a battle near Valentia, he defeated Chaeronea and Perpenna, experienced warriors who had fled to Sertorius and were serving under him as generals, and slew more than 10,000 men. 19. Pompey, elated by this victory and filled with confidence, made haste to engage Sertorius himself, so that Metellus might not share in the victory. Late in the day, they joined battle near the river Sucro, both fearing the arrival of Metellus.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.